course, you know, with England being the only place where events are going to happen in terms of New Year's Eve, it's kind of brought about a very interesting problem for people, obviously, in the other nations, other home nations such as Wales, Scotland, and Republic of Ireland. They're in a really tricky position, and even the clubs here now, especially with the last minute confirmation that clubs are going to be open, it's hard to get things into place. It's hard to get acts that you want to play, and also to basically make the club make sense in terms of operational cost. Because imagine if the green light got given so late, it's really difficult to get somebody in to fly them in to kind of play your event because, you know, so late notice. Obviously to get all the visas done because obviously now we're out of flipping the euro and whatnot. So it's a whole mad situation. And I guess RA put together a pretty decent article talking about the entire thing that I'm going to quickly read through for you right now. The headline is, "We're really in limbo land. How a lack of government guidance and support is crippling the club scene ahead of New Year's Eve." Club scenes around the world are struggling with the upheaval caused by the COVID-19 variant Omicron and the subsequent lack of the government guidance. In the UK, where Omicron has caused record highs of COVID-19 cases, a situation varies from country to country. While venues are now closed in Wales, Scotland and Northern Ireland, sorry, I said Republic of Northern Ireland, they remain open in England as owners and promoters await instructions. And again, I don't know if this is the case, but for myself anyway, just speaking for myself, this Omicron variant or whatever is happening at the moment has been one of the most contagious variants I've ever seen in my life. This has been the only time during the entire pandemic, this whole 2.5 years that we've had under it, right, where this is the one variant that's infected most of my friends than any other before. Like most of the people that I know, people that even don't go out as much as I do, who aren't super party heads, somebody that I know, even through extension, has had Omicron or has had COVID within this period. Again, I don't know how you can test for it. I don't know if you can see if you've got the variant or not, but regardless, whatever variant is going around at the moment is highly contagious. But the only saving grace about it, it's not lethal as before. I'm not seeing people going straight to hospital. I'm not seeing people having to, you know, be put on ventilators and shit. I'm just seeing everyone kind of getting it, you know, really quickly, you know, in a short space of time, but then also recovering. And also, I'm not seeing the same symptoms as like losing your sense of smell and sense of taste and shit. I've not really seen that. I've just seen people saying it's a really aggressive cold, like super debilitating, where you can't do anything, but it's not as bad as maybe, but it's not as lethal as maybe the Delta variant that obviously came about last year, was it, right? It continues here, it says, "This state of limbo has extremely damaging implications," says Michael Kill, the head of the nighttime industry. He said that this current open closed door policy cannot continue to the new year. He says extensions of business rates relief until the end of 2022 and a freeze on bounce back loan repayments and the reintroduction of furlough. By keeping venues open, the government has once again shifted the onus on the public safety onto the owners. And at the same time, Prime Minister Boris Johnson has been advising people to limit their socializing, deterring many viewers from going out. This left venues with difficult decisions on whether or not to cancel or postpone events. So as per usual with our government, they're speaking out both sides of their mouth. So they keep the venues open because they don't want the kind of pushback and the outrage from that sector, because they're very vocal, especially people like Sasha Lord and shit on social media. They kind of rally the troops and they put things in a very clear English in a way to kind of get people to understand what basically hospitality industry is facing. And they don't want that negative press, especially off the back of all these pictures that leaked of them celebrating and enjoying themselves, you know, last year when we were in lockdown and stuff. So they don't want any more bad PR. So they keep the clubs open. But then they also advise the public not to go out and socialize because it's not safe because of this Omicron variant, which obviously damages the ability of the club to attract people to come to their clubs. Because like I said beforehand, I think the major kind of lasting damage of COVID and these lockdowns has been re really has been the kind of has been the loss of the general punter, or you say the normie crowd, because I think we underestimated it, myself included, especially being a club goer, being a promoter, having been a DJ. I think I underestimated how important the normie person was to the overall landscape of Clubland. That person that just maybe pops by, or that person that maybe goes out once a month, maybe once or 6 months, they're actually maybe part of the, they're actually more important, you might say, than actually the club kids, because those people are the ones that come about every single year. They don't really care about whether or not it's cool to go out or not, but they're going to be in Soho clubs, they're going to be in clubs up north, they're going to be maybe going to do their odd bit of techno tourism in Europe, and they're going to be the ones that are going to be, you know, willing to spend money at the bar, willing to buy merch, whatever it may be, right? They're going to be there consistently, and there's going to be different variants, there's going to be different versions of the same person going to those places all throughout the year. And I think we kind of took those people for granted because we just focus on, you know, talking to the club kid and talking to the people that basically love the music like 24/7, which is obviously understandable. But I think COVID has basically pushed those people out. They've kind of got scared of it. They got scared of going to clubs because they don't want to be in an environment where they might get the virus. And they've basically, I think in general, just found new hobbies. They found other things to fill their time. They're probably not bothered about going to clubs anymore, and there's no way we're ever going to get them back. And I think that's the lasting damage of it. So again, tourism is going to be obviously a good thing once the world reopens up again, especially parts of Europe, in terms of allowing people to kind of free flow and back and forth like how I did when I went to Berlin. But I think that loss of the normie crowd is something that I don't think what clubland's ever going to recover from. And I think that might actually be a good thing in general, kind of, let's say, silver lining, in that maybe clubs now, because that normie crowd doesn't exist, there's no need to be so hell bent on making sure you book the 10 biggest DJs as listed on fucking DJ Mag list or something. You can actually be a bit more risky, because the people going to the club don't necessarily care about the ones going now aren't necessarily going only because of the names. They're going because they want to go out, right? Because you're putting yourself at risk by going out. So you're not only going to go and see Solomon, you want to go because you want to have a dance, and it is nice bonus that Solomon's playing, but it's not the only drive. So if that's the case, maybe marrying up a Solomon with like a lineup that's a bit more underground or a little bit less known might be a good thing to go with in the future. So that might be a good consequence of it. But that normie crowd, that loss in nightlife is just monumental. It continues here, it says, London Superclub Printworks chose to postpone, which is a big deal, right? They're a big club. They only stay open until 12. The whole idea when Printworks opened, it opened like in a former printworking factory here in London. The whole idea behind it, I think it, if I'm not mistaken, it opened at the same time that the night tube was reintroduced. So the idea was that you could go and party there from like 11 a.m. or something up until 12 p.m. or 12 a.m. and then you could get the first night tube back home if you needed to. So you didn't need to kind of, you know, spend money on, you know, taxis and stuff or Ubers or go on a night bus and take hours. You could still get to basically most locations in London by taking the central line or get closer to your home. That's basically the whole premise around it. So if they can't figure out how to stay open, again, it's only from 11 or sometimes 12 p.m. until 12 a.m. and they couldn't do it, it shows you, like, you know, how much damage this whole kind of, you know, will they won't they sort of thing has done to the whole club space. It continues, it says here, Richie Horton was scheduled to debut his new From Our Minds project at the venue December 18th. He said, "We had a major blow when it was cancelled," he told RA. "The most depressing and sad thing was that we let down so many of our younger artists. He's anticipating three NYE cancellations, meaning fans of disappointed clubbers and lots of wasted hard work." And also, this also goes to speak about why I kind of have some sympathy now with some of these kind of plague rave DJ guys, because I know a lot of us, it's hard to basically put yourself in the shoes of these people because they're multi-millionaires, but that's still a lot of money. Like this guy runs a label, he's got a project he's doing, he's releasing headphones and shit. Richie Horton and those kind of business techno people, they pay a lot of people's salaries. So if he's not able to play NYE shows, that means people that also take a salary from him being an artist are also going to suffer, right? They're not going to be able to pay their mortgage. They're going to be able to put their kids through school. So it has a knock-on effect. So that's probably why these people like Nina Kravitz and these Nastias and stuff, they take the most, like, nonsense bookings in maybe some hot places around the world, because it's not just about them, right? The where they're going to play, that funds or those monies or those DJ fees are going to feed other people who kind of you knock on effect. Even if you go to a smaller, even if you go to these quote unquote third world countries and you go and play when it's really red hot, those promoters actually want you to play there. The local industry maybe needs you to play there too, because there's a knock-on effect when you go play. The person that sells the little flipping pineapples outside in the street might get some extra business. The one that does whatever. Do you know what I mean? It has a knock-on effect on the economy. So it's a far-reaching thing when a DJ of that ilk isn't able to play because of governmental restrictions or whatnot. Do you know what I mean? It kind of has a knock-on effect. It says here, Palestinian DJ Summer was scheduled to play at Printworks alongside Horton. She told RA that her upcoming cancellations, including the show in Glasgow's subclub, will impact an estimated 13,000 ravers, and I'm sure most are in pocket. It says here, it's just a question of venues and artists can survive the economic hit, she said. Ultimately, the only way we can overcome this, what's happening, is to get everyone vaccinated and make large gatherings as safe as possible. But that's a problem, though. That's never going to happen. I just don't think we're going to ever get to a place, especially in the Western world, where you're ever going to get a huge majority of people vaccinated. I just think we don't run like that as a country. We don't run like that as a sector of the world, whatever it may be called, right? That whole idea about, what would you call it? What's the term called? That whole idea about putting the needs of others in front of yourself doesn't exist in the Western world. It doesn't. Like the whole idea of like the common good, it doesn't exist, because that's what basically the vaccinations are. Because there's loads of conflicting information about whether or not they work the way they're intended to work, whether or not it's a one size fits all fix. The obviously the negative effects some people are having on it. There's loads of information out there that kind of doesn't just say, okay, categorically the vaccine is the only and best option. There are other alternatives out there, and because of that people are then latching onto them. Cool. And all this access to information, and with this idea that you are an individual, and you know, the individualism maybe is a blame to this, but I just don't think we're ever going to get to a point where we're going to get higher than like an 80% adoption rate when it comes to vaccination. I just don't think that's possible. I just don't think so, especially the more time goes on, the more these variants mutate, the more maybe they become contagious but less lethal. People will start naturally asking questions and just be a bit suspicious that we just keep doing the same thing and we keep having the same results. They're not gonna just quickly jump on the idea, oh, it's just a vaccine that needs to help. They're gonna think maybe it's the other approaches. So if that's the case, we need to figure out a solution that we can do where we can kind of quote unquote live with it. Like, what's the next step? Like, if we can't get everyone vaccinated, how do we make large gatherings possible and safe? That's the next step going forward, because if we just keep going around this kind of this rigmarole, it's going to be the same. It's going to be Groundhog Day again next year around the winter time. We're going to have another variant pop up, or maybe the summer, and then suddenly all the venues will close again, because as per usual, all governments think whenever the virus spreads again that it's always these places that are that usually have people in densely packed areas that are always the mass spreaders, when usually the data doesn't say that, the evidence doesn't say that at all, but they just always go for the kind of low-hanging fruit in terms of dealing with the situation. It continues, says techno pioneer Chris Liberator, who played at the Boxing Day gig at London Fold, had his shows cancelled in France, Germany and Spain. He said that at least in other countries, you know the score because they're shutting down, he said, which is true. But in the UK, this lack of clarity is costing livelihoods. When you promote a gig, it's not just DJs affected. Like I said, there's also bar staff, cleaners, security. It's like the government's letting clubs fight a losing battle that will disintegrate into bankruptcy. You just can't work in that environment. It's better to do something to help them than pontificate. And it's true. And it's actually better to just cancel it or just lock the country down from early doors than to leave them in this weird limbo where they're waiting for an announcement. When the announcement comes, it's too late. And when it does come, it comes with a caveat, then people are put off going out. It's just nonsense. It continues here, says it's uncertain whether a 24-hour event at Fold will go ahead. We're in a constant state of knowing what's going on what's going to happen, said the general manager Miyu Bambu told RA. Staff are on standby, but we cannot guarantee work. Not knowing where your next paycheck is coming from is daunting for everyone. We need strategic thinking from the government. Every list of different scenarios they plan for would be great too, so we know what they're prepared for. Venues like Nottingham's iClub are also making their own informed decisions about opening or closing. The Let There Be House event scheduled on December 27th was cancelled after a sold out event the week before only drew 50% of ticket holders. That is brutal. That I was going to end it, but that is brutal, isn't it? And again, this definitely explains what I've been seeing out there when I've been going out myself. There's definitely a lack of actual people going to these events. A couple of parties I went to, especially the one I went to in Fold, they were completely sold out. I had to buy a ticket on a resale app, like Ticket Swap, I think I might have put it on. And when I went to the event, it was nowhere near sold out. There was plenty of room in the club, of course, which is nice because you can dance around and not be too sweaty everywhere. But there's clearly a huge dip in terms of the people that actually attend these events in real life. And that's always been an issue anyway. When you promote a night, especially when I used to promote nights and used to mainly have most of your promotion channel be Facebook, you sometimes get a little bit gas off the numbers of confirmed guests that went to go to your event. But after a couple of events, you quickly realize that usually if you've got a high number of people attending the event by clicking attending on Facebook, it usually meant that maybe 20 if not 10% of those people actually go to the event. There wasn't a lot of it, so there was no correlation between the numbers you see online via the numbers you see in real life. And now it's even worse because the people are actually paying for the tickets but they're not turning up. And why are they not turning up? Because they can afford to, because now people have a lot more disposable income because they're not maybe doing the things that they did previously when we had a knockdown, right? In the pre-lockdown world, you may be a bit more tight on money, so you'd probably just go because you've already paid for the ticket. But now if you spent 20 quid, 30 quid, even 50 quid on a ticket to go to a club, and you woke up one day, you're like, you know what, it doesn't feel safe. I feel like this Omicron variant is a bit too contagious, you could just knock it on the head and not go, and it wouldn't be that much of a bother. No, you know what I mean? You could just continue going, especially if you've got, you know, a decent job or you're earning okay. Like, you wouldn't care too tough. So it must be really, really scary for clubs now to see that, right? Proper sold out events where you sold legitimately, you know, loads of tickets beforehand, but on the day it doesn't work, because again, operating costs of the night are a lot, because when you sell out a show, I'm assuming, or an event, I'm assuming you're gonna maybe you know, hire more staff or get more staff in, maybe pump up the security. So then on the night you end up having a negative because the bar spend isn't great. You're having to, you know, overpay in terms of the staff that are there. They're obviously not getting that much work. The tips are low. It just must be so bad to deal with, man. I can't imagine how difficult it must be to work in hospitality right now in this current predicament that we're in. It must be so hard. So yeah. Force of things, guys, everybody involved. Again, New Year's Eve is going to be interesting. Like I said, I think it's going to be one of the most sloppiest New Year's Eve we've had in a while. I also think it's going to be weirdly quiet, because a lot of people that I've spoken to have decided that they're going to do what I'm going to do, which is go somewhere and have some nice dinner, maybe have a glass of wine, welcome in the new year that way, and then just go home. Do you know what I mean? Many people are doing that. So if that's the case, from the people that I know who are generally a good variety of people, from like the party heads to the chill heads, I can only imagine what everyone else is doing in terms of the quote unquote normie world. So it's going to be absolutely peak out there. It's going to be absolutely peak. And yeah, man, like, it feels like one step forward or two steps back in it. It just, whenever you think it's going to get better, it doesn't. It's just, I don't know.